I think my job is very easy. Almost all my slides were discussed by my previous colleagues. But we'll try to, you know, I feel this mixed audience, so my discussion will be bilingual, with English and Sinhala as well. Challenges, you know, for a physician, a pregnant lady is always a challenge. Because when we get a pregnant lady, maybe term with a big tummy, when we see her, we are not very comfortable like a VOJ, and of course we are not obstetricians. And on top of that, if you get a pregnant lady with influenza, suspected influenza, we are not very comfortable, and it's a challenge always to the physician. A reason for that may be, in our, when we become a consultant during our MD training, we don't get the proper exposure in this system as it is for the medical, to manage the medical problems during the pregnancy. So that's an area where the College of Physicians and Obstetricians should work together and give a training to the trainees, MD trainees, the medical graduates, the physicians during training to get exposure to manage the medical problems in pregnancy. So on top of that, the pregnant lady, influenza, and sometimes they get other conditions like diabetes, heart disease, bronchial asthma, and anemia. When that combination comes, the job is not that easy. The worst scenario is, in physician's point of view, we get late referrals. It could be due to the patient is coming to the hospital late, it was seen by a general practitioner, or the other reason is, this pregnant lady may be having another 2 or 3 kids at home. She doesn't want to come to the hospital because of the small fellows. So the presentation of the hospital is late, and immediately get the referral to the physician. And if it is a kind of a severe type of influenza-like illness, it's not that easy, maybe a difficult job. The other reason, with due respect to the obstetricians, we get sometimes we get late referrals. And so we are if we consider the whole country, may not be the castle or DMH, and the peripheries as well. When the patient comes to the obstetric ward, naturally, a pregnant lady, whatever the illness, there is a dengue or influenza, urine infection, diabetes, high pressure, headache, they go to the obstetrician first. And these conditions, if the obstetric team try to manage, that will be a problem. We have experience, you know, that the patient was admitted to a obstetric ward, and initial management was done by the obstetric team, maybe with antibiotic, maybe antiviral, whatever. And the referral to the physician is late. So that is an area where we have to improve, and we have to have a dialogue to further benefit of the patients. And could be a late diagnosis, maybe a VOG, maybe the physician, whoever, that could be a problem, and it could be a challenge. And when the diagnosis is late, and when complication comes, the patient may be transferred to another place, and another physician has to face the challenge. And it could be a wrong management. Somebody comes with influenza-like illness, given antibiotic. Sometimes, we know in this country, the family physician's job is not very regularized, and we have lots of one-shot doctors in the practice. They give steroids and make the patient in the viremic phase, giving steroid by a one-shot practitioner in the community could give a kind of very bad outcome, and the pressure comes to that, it will be a real challenge to the physician. When the patient take over, there's a pregnant lady with influenza-like illness, when we take over the patient to a medical ward, the issue is how to prevent cross-infections. Medical wards are always busy, especially during epidemic, we get the pregnant ones and the other patients as well. So we have, it's a challenge for the physician and the team to prevent cross-infections in a busy, crowded medical ward. And the other thing, when we get a except a patient with influenza like illness, then she get the exposure to the other high risk patients in the medical ward, like CKD patients, diabetes, asthmatics, COPD patients. So that will be issue. So how are we going to isolate the patient? It's a challenge. In a crowded medical ward, how are we going to isolate these patients from the rest of the patients? And we can say we can transfer the patient to the ICU, but in real life, in a government hospital, ICU facility is a dream and a miracle. It's not that easy. So ICU setup is, it's maybe sometimes, maybe not a reality. Drugs, medicine, antiviral, antibiotic, in real life, when we work in the government hospital, sister comes, OS, so this is the real life. So those are the things that we have to discuss when we face this kind of infection, when we think about the epidemic, and we are facing the media, and at the end of the day, though these deficiencies are there, we are responsible for the patient's life. And how are you going to mobilize the staff? Imagine, you know, that we get a patient, or two, or three, or so, to a medical ward. Now the staff, we have the limited staff, and maybe pregnant nurses in the medical ward. So then, mokada karanne mata thadeyida. So how are you going to tackle that area? What is the dialogue we are going to have the ward sister? It's a challenge. That is a thing that we have to think about in future. What kind of measures we are going to take that kind of scenario? And how are you going to educate the patient and the family? Monada kiyanne the patient comes, mama meraida giya kalin merala thiyenone family ara mahathyata pennannada me hospitalata yannada ICU daanawada mata thadeida all kind of things. And the media, if a single death occurs, then it will be a big pressure to the hospital and the team, because many the media is behind you, because simply because they need some kind of news. So we can't recognize the media. That's their job. If everybody is okay, they don't have a job. You know, they will cannot come and say okkoma lidi sanipuna kavuruth merunne hari mod hospitale eka wenna kawada. If there's a single death, next day they will be there and with the TV team, and it will be in the newspapers. This is their job. We have to respect that. So how to tackle the media? It's again a challenge. This slide is discussed over and again. When you suspect influenza like illness, in very simple language, medavasara kauru hari unahadila kottu hura hura kaha kaha sothrot ki ekek katanda wenas wala ena nan eigullanta thiyenne meka thama. Right? So if it is pregnant, we have to be careful. If not, you know, tell them not to worry. Basolt ekek ahinawa nan kottu hurenawa nan katanda wenas wala gora gora gala katha karanawa nan e eigullo. Bankuwata giyama ehema karanawa nan eith eigullo. ඒක නිසා දැන් අපි සමරන සසලෙමත් අතර පේනවා ගිහිල්ලා කියන්නේ දැන් එහෙම ලෙඩෙක් ආවා කියලා දුවගෙන යන්න ඕනේ නැහැ. If you are young and healthy, though you exposed to these patients, you should take real precautions. You will not get the infection. Though you get the infection, nothing will happen. It's, you know, very unlikely to create problems to the young people, but still you have to take precaution. So it's very common, it's everywhere. It's not in the hospital, is not only in the isolation room, it's in the bank, it's in the bus hall, wherever you, temple, wherever you go. Kaha kaha otoro ora arlin sing innawana me egulu tama. But the important thing is we should not miss the other things. Me dawasala una thiyenawa kiyala ena hamoma influenza nemi. For example, if somebody coming kasthana ingirisawana oturanne angiri denawa una thiyenawa, etakota egollu yanne dengue group ekata. So then you have to, you can't miss a dengue because it is equally or more dangerous illness. Etakota me dawasala inna una gode dengue ekkena adura ganawa. Again you might get a lepto with exposure to the lepto exposure working in a paddy field or wherever. So you have to get a good history. Though there's an epidemic of influenza, you can't miss a leptospirosis patient. If that one died, it's palavini ga apada pau deka apada dukai tuna, that will be the end of your reputation. And it could be a simple viral fever. dengue nemei, leptot nemei, influenza nemei, it could be simple viral fever. And it could be a bacterial infection. In that case, we have to start some kind of antibiotic early stages. Come influenza kila antibiotic nadi inna bae mulu. Then if you think it's a bacterial infection with suggestive things like blood count, high CRP and things like that, then we have to do the cultures and start antibiotics early. How are you going to treat them? Then, kalamu the inni aragollu ekane kaha kaha otu hura hura nahi tiyagena lensu ganna katti, you know what they do? They eat some paracetamol, kottamalli beela, hondara wathura beela nida ganna. So that is the basic treatment. You need rest, you have to avoid dehydration, you take some paracetamol and don't go to work and rest at home. That is the main thing. But as we are in audience with concentrate on the pregnant one, we have to be little careful. Then again the treatment wise not much of difference. Paracetamol, we don't give any NSAIDs, and especially in a country like Sri Lanka where the dengue is around, fever, no NSAIDs, no place. And we can give something like chlorpheniramine or maybe loratadine or something like that, because it reduces the secretions. My previous colleagues, they explained it to me. It goes from the secretions, nasal secretions. So if you can have a way to reduce the secretions, then that means first thing you can reduce the symptoms of the patient and patient will be more comfortable. Second thing is you can reduce the secretions, you can prevent the spread. And the inhalers, for the same reason, if it is a kind of bronchitis, you give the inhalers, the patient will be comfortable. Nattan kaha kaya na, oye dostara mahatte, anit dostara mahatte, me ispiritare, anit ispiritama kahino. So reduce the symptoms, keep the patient comfortable and reduce the secretions and prevent, minimize the transition. Nebulization, yes. We have to think about nebulization. Sometimes the patients are really ill, and I'll come that topic, and oxygen and antiviral therapy. Antiviral therapy, if it is young and fit man, comes with cough and cold and hemdirisar, you just advise them, paracetamol, rehydration, and you need some rest, don't go to work, that kind of thing. But if you get a pregnant one, for a patient with high risk, maybe CKD, diabetic, immunodeficiency like Dr. June said, you start the Tamiflu on clinical grounds. And in severe cases, if the patient is dyspneic, it's better to go for a double dose, that is 150 milligrams, not for 5 days. We have to give a prolonged course, maybe up to 10 days. Basic management guidelines we discuss, my previous colleagues. But basically, if somebody is pregnant, not settling within 48 hours, admit the patient. It's same as dengue. Dengue also, we do the same. And second important thing is not to miss the other things like maybe dengue, maybe lepto, not to miss the other important infections. And do the H1N1 screen, and you may not be happy with that, because when we are doing an epidemic, we won't be able to screen everybody. On clinical grounds, we start treatment, because when we get thousands of patients, it's no point sending specimen to MRI and give a burn to them. But don't think about other medical conditions like maybe bacterial infections, urinary tract infections, so do the cultures, blood cultures, urine cultures, and dengue antigen, etc. And if in an epidemic, if you get a patient with urinary tract infection, you treat them hard and try to make sure that the patient is not a dengue or H1N1, and discharge them from the hospital as soon as possible. Otherwise, the patient might end up with H1N1. So last time we had this little experience, everybody comes to the hospital with fever. They were placed in a separate area. So all the H1N1, dengue, lepto, and UTIs were in the same place, and the UTI infections went home after getting H1N1 infection from the hospital. So we have to screen them and separate the other people with women with other infections, and not to put them with the influenza patients. And so we discuss it. If you think it's influenza and pregnant or immunodeficient, start treatment on suspicious. and don't stop the medicine. Though the H1N1 test is negative, Dr. Jude clearly said there are lots of factors contribute for the positive results. So if you get a positive thing, it's positive. If you get a negative report, still it could be negative. So better to complete, if you start the medicine, you complete the course. Dr. Pabha will provide the treatment for the whole nation, so don't worry about it if you suspect. And patients who are really indicated ones, not for everybody, not for your friends, not for your colleagues, not for your SHO or registrar, and so if somebody comes with pregnancy or asthmatics could deteriorate with influenza-like illness, be careful and don't discharge them as soon as fever settle. They might come back to you, we might lose the patient, be careful. And close supervision during the delivery, and doctor, then he did discuss that part. And antibiotic, yes, we have to consider. Even this morning I had to see a patient, not my colleague's patient, came with H1N1 and deteriorated, now in secondary bacterial infection with high CRP, then you have to hit hard with relevant antibiotic depending on the place. If the patient in ICU, then we have to think about MRSA, acinetobacter, all kind of things. So you can't say this is H1N1 positive, not giving antibiotics. So it's a very individual decision. So you appropriately have to start antibiotic in relevant cases. So we are going to reduce the secretions by giving clofenilamine, etc. And the other thing, the proper waste management. And hospital එකට ආවහම ඔය හොටු හුර හුර දාලා ලේන්සු රෙදි කෑලි පත්‍ර ඕවෙන් තමයි අනික් කටට බොවෙන්නේ. So we have to have a good way to dispose these things. ඔය waste කොහොමද එළියට යන්නේ? ඒක තමයි එක. මොකද එක බ්ලඩ් එකක් ඇවිල්ලා ඒ මනුස්සය හොටු හුර ලේන්සු වී පත්‍ර කෑලි රෙදි කෑලි අත පීදානේ වයිම නැත්තම් බිත්ති අත ගානේ වයි. තව 10 දිනකට හැදෙන්න පුළුවන්. So it's very important to have an idea about the proper waste management to prevent or minimize the infection. And minimize the nebulizer. The henna hemotome nebulizer karaniyan nepa. The other thing that if you use the nebulizer, same nebulizer, you know, we in the government sector, we know, we have a nebulizer and the tube and the mask. We don't have many. So what we do, we give the nebulizer this patient and that patient and next patient. Maximum what we do, we wash the thing. It's not, one thing which you could do, if possible, you ask the patient to buy a separate mask and tube. So the machine is common, but the tube and the mask is for the individual patient. We redama tiya gannawara tube ekai mask ekai okara machine ekata gahali werala ya nebulize kala ya galawala ya gawa tiya ganna. Eyaka wash karaganna. Ita passe wenek kirana wenne. So sometimes hospital may not be able to provide all these things, but for the people who could afford, try to buy the individual face mask and the tube. And we have to provide the metered dose inhalers again for the people who could afford those things. We can ask them to buy, but people who can't afford, we can use our hospital resources. Early discharge is something which we have to consider if the patient is safe, and always it's a good culture to give a telephone call and see how the patient is going on, whether there's an infection going on among the family members. So the adequate supply of drugs, the ministry should look into that whenever there is an epidemic, and epidemiology will alarm the ministry regarding the outbreak. So in advance they have to get these adequate stocks of antiviral, antibiotics, face masks, gloves and N95 masks only for appropriate cases. N95 thiyenne consultant ay SHO ay registrar ay danna neme eka thiyenne ara suck out aspirate karanne kenata physiotherapist danna. For us, as we are not doing that kind of interventional job, simple face mask is enough. නැත්තම් වෙන්නේ ඉස්පිරිතාල දින N95 ටික ගහලා අපේ මේ සුලින් ඉන්නවා කියන මෙන්න සර්ගේ N95 ටික කියලා. That is, we don't do that kind of test. People who are doing the real job, sucking the secretions and tubes, they need the N95. And nebulizers, separate tube, oxygen, adequate supply of disinfectants. Yes, that's very important. Whenever there's epidemic, we have to do the cleaning part very well. And nebulizers, maybe the tubes, especially in the intensive care unit, people who are on ventilators, need to do a proper disinfection. So we have to get down those things, adequate stocks to prevent, minimize the infections. And yes, good hand hygiene. That's the most important thing. Okay, that kahami din pana dakala gena duwanno ne hema tarama I told you banko inno pansala inno spiritual inno hema tarama inno influenza kattiya ata ata moonu naha yallanne pa kiyanna ata soda ganna kiyanna a good hand hygiene and those disciplines are enough to prevent or picking up the infection to and the patients also advised to discourage from nose picking and you know limit touching the other things and healthcare workers should provide the face mask in adequate amounts whenever they expose the patient. It's ideally we need a separate area in the hospital for this kind of situation. So we have to think about those things in advance in this kind of epidemic. What are the things which are going to do? N95 is only people for who are doing the procedures, and it's very important to limit the visitors and the relatives to the. To see the patients, otherwise they will take it to their home and come back in busloads. So patients, whenever there is an epidemic, and if you get lots of patients in the hospital, so that is a new environment, new culture. So naturally, the staff will get panic. The nurses and the doctors, minor staff, then are they getting put with all the kind of OPD, getting little karangiya gamamma, pay the heavy minor staff, you know. So that is the culture in real life. So you have to educate them. We have to have regular programs to all the staff categories, the doctors in a different level, nurses in another level, and minor staff in a very simple level, not to get panic and not to pass unnecessary medicine. Sick leave report, then you won't be able to run the hospital. And the practical demonstration of disinfecting procedures by the microbiology or virologists is very important. For example, then we have tubes, and what do you call that, IT tubes and things like that. Sometimes they tend to wash those things with disinfectant. That's not enough. They have to push a brush inside the tube and clean it. So unless the you guys and microbiologists come and educate the nurses and the sisters, it won't happen. So just the washing by using a disinfectant is not enough. So in real life, you should come to the field and educate the people how to do that. Especially the ICU staff and high-end hygiene and handling the panic staff is important. Lab diagnosis is discussed. I'm not going to touch that area. When it comes to the real life, the best report you can get it from the MRI. But the rapid test is done by lots of places in the private sector. In simple language, if you get a positive report from a private sector or the MRI, that means this patient has got h1n1. You are correct. And if it is a negative report, you can't exclude it. Still, it could be H1N1. So the procedure, what MRI is doing, is more expensive and more accurate. And so you can't use the MRI all the time, and some people don't like to come to the government sector. Some people, it's easy to get the things in the private sector. So if it is positive, it's positive. If it is negative, still you have to consider the patient is having H1N1. If you have doubt, then you can send the samples to the MRI, repeat sample. We have experience in that kind of situations. You know that, you know, negative reports from the MRI, private sector, patient is highly suggestive of H1N1 with complications, and the test done at MRI is positive. And the problems what we encounter in the ward is the lack of training in sample collection and transport. So though and explain it nicely in this audience, it is, you know, this message should go to the all the hospitals in the country, and how to do that, and I think we have to have some kind of system. And details, clinical history is important, and we have to do that. and the specimen storage before transfer, explain those are the things which we have to tackle. And it's very important to identify the complications. Because then, then if you get a patient with h1n1 and you know coming cough and cold and fever oka dawath deka thunak wenna unna behala inna wela ganna puluwan wela kala deela gedara yana so that is the scenario in 99.9 cases ekkine kudu ekapaata homoma indala ekapaata yak wenoda winda usma ganna ba athiya ehema kiya you know kalpana na poddan wediyen nida gannawa wenada wage harinna kanna puluwan eyawa thama andura ganna so you we should detect the complication, not the normal patient. Complications in a patient's life. The people who are coming with this cough and cold, how are they going to get rid of it? When are they going to get in? And then negative in? Who's not going to be? When it comes to personal experience, we have, you know, there are some instances that patients are dyspneic and the patient was referred to a psychiatrist. Because hypoxic, hema situation is apet tibuna. So, lost the patient eventually. So, And the important thing as clinicians, we should know in viral pneumonias and viral bronchopneumonias and viral bronchitis, signs are minimum. අපි ස්ටෙප් එක තිබුවාම ක්‍රෙප්ස් හැනවනේ අපි ඉතින් යාට මොකයි තියෙනවා ක්‍රෙප්ස් තියෙනවා මෙයාට හොඳ නැහැ කියලා වෛරල් කට්ටියගේ සයින්ස් නෑ patient deteriorate වෙනවා patient saturation බහිනවා patient hypoxic වෙනවා patient confused වෙනවා so that is the scenario and එතකොට the clinicians might think ah no මෙයාගේ කුකුත් සයින් නෑ රොන්කයි නෑ ක්‍රෙප්ස් නෑ මෙයා psychiatric මෙයා panic වෙලා මෙයා anxious so that is not the case in viral bronchopneumonias they behave in a different way ICU and HDU. ICU nanny, so we have to forget about the ICU business. In government hospitals, we don't have ICU. We have assumed that we don't have ICU facility. Because the bed to na khatra piyari na iskita alika. Okay, my god manage karan do na. Pre-eclampsia god manage karan do na. Okkumatik manage karan do na. 1 minute. So we have to create a HDU. So in real life. So how are you going to create a HDU? We have to find a proper place. Who are the staff? Staff in the HDU or ward staff than a man. So we have to get nurses from the ICU or the theatre, trained nurses who could manage the outbreak. We have to have a team starting from the director, physician, BOG, anesthetist, microbiologist, virologist, epidemiologist, nursing officers, pharmacists, MSD, ministry, Okumadala team. And after the delivery, yes, it's the teamwork. Breastfeeding, we can treat them with Tamiflu and it's not contraindicated during pregnancy. And we have to have a good discharge plan and complete the antivirals, notify the thing, otherwise we don't know about the situation in the country. And if there's a complicated case, the junior doctor should not discharge the patient, you need a higher level authority and we have to have a follow-up plan. Thank you.